I am now president of the Netherlands Organization for Scientific Research, but I'm also still very, very, very much part-time at the National Institute for Particle Physics in the Netherlands and at the Faculty of Science at the University of Amsterdam. Now, my field in physics is about started, but I never left it, in fact. And this is not a holistic picture of the universe. It's a very simplistic one. It lists the structure of matter. So we're starting from molecules all the way up to to quarks there. So that the interactions between the most fundamental constituents of matter and their fields, that is the subject study of particle physics, of high energy physics. And what we have found is that quarks and leptons, like the electron, appear as the constituents of ordinary matter. All this is composed of nothing more than you see there, and you and I too, for that matter. But we have discovered that that's the fields that act between those particles. We have discovered more generations. If you know why there should be three generations to explain all this, then you can book your plane to Stockholm right away. All of this is embedded in a theoretical framework called the Standard Model that was incomplete. And there is a sector that you need on theoretical grounds that was not discovered yet. So this is what Higgs in some form and Broud and D'Anglaire wrote down many years ago, and then the experimental physicists like myself started to chasing the object H. Now, as you know, it's not totally the unknown anymore. It has been found at CERN, this particle, but if you see there, in this cartoon that I use for many years, the Higgs indicated there. The Higgs is now, we know what it is, that it is there, that it exists. Looking for the Higgs was very frustrating for a long time because it was not sure that we didn't find it because we were not clever enough or that it simply didn't exist. Now, finally, we know that it exists, it is there. We know its mass and its couplings. But the hope of every physicist, certainly of every young physicist, are the question marks. And we have not found any question mark yet. We have found the Higgs so far, and that is it. And that cannot be true, of course. That is the theoretical framework, as I said. Now, how do you do that? In order to produce heavy particles or to probe the smallest distances of matter, you need high energies. And high energies you can achieve by building particle accelerators. And what you see here is an aerial photo it's near Geneva, that's Lake Geneva up there. And the big circle is an underground tunnel, a 27-kilometer ring where a big accelerator is located. And that was the big flagship project of CERN, and that was commissioned and completed during the time that I was there as a director. Now, the mission of CERN is, of course, to do research and to push back frontiers of knowledge and also of know-how, to develop technology, to provide a training environment, and to stimulate international collaboration. CERN was, in fact, founded after the first worst World War in order to stimulate peace in Europe by cooperation. This is a view of the underground area, so this is in this 27-kilometer tunnel, and this indicates some of the features of this largest accelerator of this moment. Now, schematically, the particles are accelerated in a linear accelerator first. They're boosted. They go into a small accelerator that was state-of-the-art in 1959 and that is still being used. So it was heavily over-designed at that time. but it is still there. Then you inject in the SPS, which was once called superproton synchrotron, and then they get further accelerated and they're injected into this big ring. And then you do the same thing into the other directions, and then you make the particles collide down in big experimental areas, and the beams, they continue coasting for 8 or 10 hours, and then you can make your measurements and of course later analyze them. This is to illustrate that the equipment underground are really very sophisticated, state-of-the-art, radiation-hard, fast detectors with highly integrated electronics and all that, state-of-the-art. So that is what also I have worked on over the past years. Now, the discovery of the Higgs was then crowned with a Nobel Prize for the persons who had the theoretical idea, Englert at the left and Higgs at the right. Braut, the co-worker of Englert, he is no longer with us, unfortunately. He should have been there as well, of course. But this Nobel Prize is also considered partly a success for CERN. Now, let me come to more organizational and governance matters. CERN, I was a summer student at CERN long ago. I was a postdoc at CERN. I was a staff member and I was a director. So I know many facets of the organization. And as a director, I've worked with CERN Council, sitting at the other side of the table as now. So I know how councils work. CERN was founded in 1954, as I said, by then 12 European states. Today CERN has 21 member states listed there, a few candidates for accession, and very, very importantly also, that was also very important in the period that I was there, observers to Council who have bilateral agreements with the organization to contribute, of course, to its functioning, and also to then have a right to exploit and use the facilities. CERN has roughly 2,300 staff members, as is indicated there, but very importantly also very many users. So those are like the contacts of EASA. Those are the physicists who have a home base in their own country, in their own lab, who would then visit CERN for longer or shorter periods to do their experiments there. Now, this is not my own slide. I had to update it, so I got it from the present director general. And in my time, I could never get away with a tilde in front of the budget. I also always had to specify exactly what the budget was, but presently Council of CERN is accepting that the director general roughly needs €1 billion, roughly. This is an interesting picture that is reminiscent of things we saw. And there is a quite striking similarity. So what you see here is in blue the member states of CERN, in green the observer states, and in red the states that have one way or another a cooperation agreement with CERN. So they have a physics community that is able to profit from and contribute to CERN. Now this is somewhat more colored than the EASA map, but there is a striking similarity in that is that the African continent, with the exception of South Africa and Egypt, is not not colored. Now, if you do fundamental science, that's what we do it for. Then of course you should. The spin-offs are there, the technological and technical spin-offs. There is one spin-off that you all know, and that is this one. It says, it's from 89. It says, Information Management, a Proposal. And then somebody who had to, who had to sort of process this proposal, says, vague but exciting. I've read the thing. The author asks 250,000 Swiss francs to work out an ID he had. Now, the author was Tim Berners-Lee, and what you see here is his vision of what became the World Wide Web. There are also many, many other applications, of course, in therapy, but also in imaging. So you can use particle beams for many purposes and particle detectors also for many purposes, more than just the purposes they were initially built for. Now, I came back from CERN and I wanted to go back into research, and then the then Dutch minister, I'm still in my position, he's no longer, asked me to become president of NWO. Now, I had to consider that for a while, because being president is, of course, very important, and it makes you feel very important, but it is not nothing to do with science, right? You fund scientists, but I convinced myself that funding excellent scientists is also worth doing. So NWO grants proposals from universities most of the time, but the organization, and that's somewhat atypical, but on the Dutch scale that is perfect, also has a number of own research institutes. And the priorities of the organization are, of course, funding talent, young talent and not so young talent, and free research proposals. So research that is proposed bottom-up. On the other hand, we are asked to, and we should, and we are, of course, as scientists, also very motivated to invest in themes, societally inspired themes. We have to get the knowledge one way or another back to society or to the private sector. International cooperation is a priority in itself, and that is why NWO is the Dutch NMO for EASA. Access to research facilities, and then consolidate the national role of the NWO institutes. I could also add now that open access publishing is one of these priorities. But I saw lots of natures come by again today, which is very good, but which is also very bad. The themes, so this is not the free research, so to speak, but the themes are on these issues that you recognize, and some, like for example the last one, is more typically Dutch than others, and others you recognize as even of interest to the science program of EASA. Now, government has defined economic priority areas. I will not go into the details. We have to work them one, and we have worked them successfully into our strategy. Then we have to look at Europe, what Europe's strategies are, and that we have to make into one coherent strategy for the country. As I said, let me go to the next one. NWO also operates a number of institutes. They are at a distance of the board of NWO. They have their own boards, so also they have to compete for their funding. But some of them operate larger infrastructures, and of course you can't compete for your infrastructure every year. So these are our institutes in the field of radio astronomy, mathematics, informatics, research of the sea. This is criminology, that is space research, that is high energy physics, and that is atomic and molecular physics, and that is energy production. Now, this is my last slide, so what are my credentials to be on the EASA Council? EASA is there for global science, science of the globe, and for global science. And I believe that EASA in that has a quite unique and successful mission. And I find it very interesting to follow and help what is happening here. It is in particular, its added value is a center of excellence for research, and thereby also for training, obviously. And then what is in it for the member organization, that is of course the cooperation, as we also heard today, with researchers in the countries represented by the member organizations. So that was those were my credentials to be here.